Hello students, so welcome to this session. Quickly give a confirmation, student, and put the lecture link also in your group. I'll just put it. Students, let's then start with the today's session. Would be an important one because we today will target on the provision of section 47, students. The provision of section 47. So that would be the backdrop of our discussion today, primarily. Nishank, good evening. So students, herein, in the last lecture, I have already given you this entire flow chart, which you have already copied this particular part. And I have also told you about the fundamental concept, as well was being told to all of you, about how we are going to go about it. Priyanka, good evening. 47 students, I have given you, in fact, in all, the three main aspect about what you need to know for your examination purpose. The three main aspect. Which are those three main aspects? One was about the case of the death of a person. And in consequence of the death of that person, there is a transfer which has taken place. And therefore, the transfer of or in consequence of the death of the person will not be considered to be a taxable transfer. I had given you certain examples also, like for an individual, he dies a natural death and the asset is transferred to the legal heirs. In fact, even without his death, if he is giving the asset as a gift, that also in the hands of the transfer, that also in the hands of the transfer will not be charged to the capital gains. Second is, students, the HUF part. I've also told you about the point of the HUF, wherein HUF also, students, on their full partition, when they transfer the capital asset, on their full partition, when they transfer the capital asset, again will not be chargeable to any capital gains. HUF will not be chargeable to any capital gains. Good evening, Jibin. And we have done in the last lecture about the liquidation of the company. In the case of the liquidation of the company as well, the same proposition arises. We have seen in the last lecture that when the company gets liquidated and the company who transfers the asset at the time of its liquidation, the company will not be charged to the capital gains tax. The company will not be charged to capital gains tax. However, students, we have discussed, if you can recall that, in the previous lecture, which was about the shareholder, students. The shareholder will be liable for the capital gains tax. The shareholder will be liable for the capital gains tax. So these were the discussion that we had so far. Apart from that, the second point of 47 that you should know for your examination point of view is that of the business restructuring. Is that of the business restructuring, students. So in the context of business restructuring, namely amalgamation, demerger, so there are a series of the business restructuring. In all these cases, if there is a transfer that take place of the asset, then those assets will not be considered to be what? A taxable transfer in the hands of the transferor, and accordingly, the capital gains will not be liable in the hands of the transfer. And the third one, which I've talked about it in this 47, was the financial asset being transferred. And the two examples which I have given it to you that you need to remember is, one is a conversion of the debentures into the shares, equity shares, and the second one is a conversion of a preference shares into the equity shares. Even in both the cases, whenever these conversion takes place of the financial asset, whenever the conversion take place of the financial asset, it will not be considered as a taxable transfer. So just we will discuss thoroughly and carefully these three items for the purpose of our discussion. So let's quickly get into it. all of you students will be taking across this particular part carefully now. So here lies this transaction which is not regarded as a taxable transfer. Trinath, good evening. This is your page number 48385. So here students, I have discussed this part, total or partial partition of the HUF. So this is about the category 1. I'll just write here in my category 1. This is my category 1. Even that gift and will I have spoken just now students. Even in the case of the gift and the will, it will not be considered to be a taxable transfer. Let's see this particular part, however. Although this is something which I always say for final CA students, but still I'll just read it for all of you. We'll try to just briefly understand what it says. However, this clause shall not include transfer under a gift or an irrevocable trust of a capital asset being shared, debentures or warrants allotted by company. So who's the transfer? Who's the allotment? Who's the one who's allotting? The company, directly or indirectly to its employee under the ESOP plan in accordance with the guideline issued on this behalf by the central government. Students, what happens is that if the company gives the ESOP shares to this particular entity, that is the shareholders, then in respect of that ESOP, they have made it very clear that this particular clause of 47, gift or will not be made applicable. So students, this particular part, primarily, that is to say, the taxation will then apply. The taxation will then apply in the hands of the transferor. Okay, so that is one point that they are trying to suggest in this regard. You just forget it, because this is something that we do analyze in the final CA level, but just for the timing. Point number 3, transfer of a capital asset by holding company. Now students, even this you will skip. So what are the category 1 which we are going to discuss? I'm just putting across this one, because now category 1 is about that. Thereafter, liquidation also would be the category 1. Liquidation, I think that is in which page, the chart. This is also my category 1. Category 1. And when I say category 1, it means that it will not be considered to be a taxable transfer as per what we have discussed in the previous class. 3 and 4 students, you will skip it. And now comes the entire context. 5, 6, 7, 8. So first of all students, here, if you see, this is your category 2. All these are category 2. So 5 to 8. 5 to 8, we will say category 2. Category 2. Now what exactly it would be in the context of 5 to 8 students herein? Shai Siva, good evening. So 5 to 8 students, let's look upon this carefully one by one. Transfer of a capital asset by the amalgamating company to the amalgamated Indian company in a scheme of the amalgamation. So who is the amalgamated company? The buying company has to be an Indian company, students. The buying company has to be an Indian company. So if the buying company happens to be an Indian company, then in that particular case, this transfer of a capital asset by the amalgamating company to the amalgamated company, which is an Indian company, in the scheme of the amalgamation, it will not be considered as a taxable transfer. I just have told you this particular point. The only condition, students, to be satisfied is that the buying company should be an Indian company. This is the only point that you should be very careful about it. If you see, even in the case of the point number 6, point number 6 students, what happens in the case of point number 6? The transfer of a capital asset by the demerged company to the resulting Indian company in a scheme of a demerger. Okay. Now, even this particular point, if you see, it goes on the similar lines. So the demerged company, whatever it had, the say one unit of that company, they spin off means they take off, and that unit will become as an independent company. That is the concept of a demerger. That unit will then become a independent company. That is what is the concept of a demerger. And accordingly students, in that particular context, the transfer of the assets that is being made will then not be considered as a taxable transfer. will then not be considered as a taxable transfer. That is what this section 47, students. This is what the section 47 is all about. So, provided the resulting company will be, should be what? Should be an Indian company. A classic example, students, is about Tata Sons. Tata Sons is a demerged company, whereas TCS is the resulting company. Similarly, even Tata Motors, private Tata Motors Limited, Tata Chemicals, they are all the demerged, they are all the resulting company. And what is the demerged company? The demerged company was the Tata Sons. Originally, everyone were part and parcel of Tata Sons. Thereafter, through the process of the demerger, 1-1 Unit started becoming an independent company. 1-1 Unit started becoming an independent company, and therefore we say that these are the cases of the resulting company. These are all, students, the cases of what? Of the resulting companies. TCS, Tata Motors, Tata Chemicals, they are all resulting company. So whenever there is a transfer of the capital asset by Tata Sons to the Tata Motors or the TCS, the fact that these transferee company or the resulting company, they are the Indian company, therefore on such transfer the transferor will be eligible for the exemption. That is, 47 will come into picture and it will not be considered as a taxable transfer. Now, if you see, students, point number 7 and 8 is all about the shares. Is all about what? Is all about the shares. Now, what exactly this concept of shares is all about? As I told you earlier, in fact, in the last lecture also, we have discussed this particular point, that I am the shareholder of the amalgamating company. I am the shareholder of the amalgamating company. Now, what I'm going to do? I will give the shares of the amalgamating company to get the shares of the amalgamated company. To get the shares of what? To get the shares of the amalgamated company. So therefore, whether this exchange of the shares of the amalgamating company to receive the shares of the amalgamated company, will this exchange be considered as a part of the taxable transfer? And the answer is no. And that exactly what they are trying to suggest. Through the shareholder's perspective also, it will not be considered, provided these are the two conditions that has to be satisfied. And what are those two conditions that has to be satisfied? Point number one, the transfer is made in consideration of the allotment to him of the shares in the amalgamated company. And the second one is about the amalgamated company, that is the shares of the company which I'm receiving is that of the Indian company. The shares of the company which I am receiving is that of the Indian company, meaning thereby the amalgamated should be an Indian company. So, quick example, students, let's look upon to this. Where A Limited, an Indian company, holds 60% of the shares in B Limited. And thereafter, herein, Anand Kumar, good evening. And thereafter, B Limited amalgamates with A Limited. B Limited amalgamates, students, with whom? With A Limited. Since A Limited itself is a shareholder of B Limited, obviously, students, if I am the shareholder, primarily, can I be getting my own shares? See, the amalgamated company was also the shareholder of the amalgamating company. This is the example that they are giving it. The amalgamated company was the shareholder of the amalgamating company. So whether when I'm issuing the shares, when the amalgamated company is issuing the shares to the shareholders of the amalgamating company, can it issue the share, its own share, to itself? And the answer is no. So that is what they're trying to say about it, that if you are the shareholder of your own particular company, then that would be eliminated. That will be excluded. So that will not be considered at all. If you are the shareholder yourself, will not be then issuing the share to yourself. The illustration, students, we have already have discussed, but I'm just going to quickly go through this question also. So M held 2000 shares in a company ABC Limited. M is a shareholder. This company amalgamated with another company during the previous year ending 31st March 2020. Under the scheme of the amalgamation, M was allotted 1000 shares in the new company, students. And the market value of the shares allotted is higher by 50,000. Then the value of the holding in ABC Limited, whatever be the market value of the amalgamated company shares, the fact that all the conditions are satisfied, I, as a shareholder of the amalgamating company, am receiving the shares I am receiving the shares of the amalgamated company in exchange of my shares of the amalgamating company, then I will be eligible for the exemption on such transfer, provided the amalgamated company is an Indian company. And it is very clear that the ABC Limited, it is clear that the amalgamated company is an Indian company in this case. Now the assessing officer wants to tax that extra 50,000, which is the higher value of the shares of the amalgamated company which I have received. Whether that extra 50,000 value which I have received in respect of the shares of the amalgamated company, can that be charged to tax? And the answer is no. So 47 is going to come for my protection, and I'm not subject to this particular taxability. Okay, and now students, this is my category 3. Category 3. And what is this category 3? Transfer on conversion of bonds or debentures. As I was telling to all of you, the financial asset conversion, that is there. So just keep in mind only this much what I have taught you students. Just you have to remember them. And thereafter, in follow-up of this, you have to remember one more point. Are you aware of this judgment of Manjula Shah's case? Students, are you aware of this Manjula Shah's case? Say quickly. Are you aware of this Manjula Shah's case? Priyanka? Trinath? Thomas? Nishank? Students, pay attention to this one. Now, in all the category 1, category 2 or category 3, when subsequently I am going to transfer this asset, what will be the situation? That is what we are going to discuss. So let's look upon to this particular proposition. So 47 students, you will remember like this always in for section 47. As I told you, you can write the page number of your module that you are referring right now. And Manjula Shah's case, you have to know students in your IPCC intermediate as well. You cannot let it go. I think maybe you may be aware of it, but through the name of the case law, but it is very popular judgment, even used by the ICI in their modules and all, in their examination as well. So section 47, we have divided into the three categories. I'm not again going to repeat the three categories: category 1, category 2 and category 3. And the other one, I will say this to be miscellaneous. Category 4, like miscellaneous. In the miscellaneous part, we'll do the reverse mortgage. In this part, students, what are we going to do? The reverse mortgage. Miscellaneous part, you can simply write reverse mortgage. Reverse mortgage. Okay, students. So these are the three categories that you should always keep in mind. Now what happens? Now you can take anything as simple as that. So in respect of this three category, common points to be noted is as below. What is that common point that you need to take a note of, students? Be very careful about it. So the common point, students, that you need, that is to be noted, is as below. Say the year 1, the father has acquired the asset at rupees 100. Okay, year 3, it was gifted, say, to his son, fair market value was, say, rupees 125. in year 4, Sun has solely asset 4 rupees 200. Now, as we have discussed just now, here section 47 will come into play. Section 47 will come into play. In this regard. And what about year number 4? Now, so far as year number 4 is concerned, here the capital gains will be taxable. The full value of consideration would be rupees 200. Less, as I told you, index cost of acquisition. Now, how do you know that there is an indexation would be applied? The concept of period of holding will come into play. Will I do the clubbing of the period of holding while I decide whether it is a long term or short term? This is, as I told you students, it is common for all the three categories. Category 1, category 2 and category 3. In all the three categories, this point is the common point. So will I be doing the clubbing of the period of holding in all the three cases? And the answer is yes, I am going to do the clubbing of the period of holding. Yes, students. So therefore, Nishank, Pavan, Shaurya, so in this case, will I be doing this particular part, students, here? And the answer is the clubbing of period of holding has to be done. And that exactly was the provision of section, here in this provision of section 2 clause 42A. They say that in all this category 1, students, category 2 and category 3, all the three categories, you will do the clubbing of the period of holding. You will do what? The clubbing of the period of holding. So that is what you will all take into account. And therefore, now you can say herein, the period of holding, I will just write POH, the period of holding, shall be clubbed. And therefore, it is from year 1 to year 4 is what has to be considered. And accordingly, this has made this to be a long-term capital asset. By doing the clubbing of period of holding, this has become a long-term capital asset. And if it is the case, then how you will go about it? 100 is the cost. And now this 100, in such cases, students, you will take the cost to be the cost to the previous owner. Cost to the previous owner, PO, that is cost to the previous owner, into the indexation of the year of transfer, which is year number 4, divided by, this is where Manjula Shah came into picture. This is where Manjula Shah came into picture, CII of year number 1. So what Manjula Shah said was that when you are taking the cost to be the cost of the previous owner, when you are doing the indexation from the year in which the previous owner has acquired the property, so in that particular case, when you are determining the nature of the capital asset based on when the previous owner has acquired the property, so therefore the indexation also has to be applied from the year in which the previous owner has acquired the property. Otherwise, how that is possible that you take the cost of the previous owner and you take up the indexation from some other date or some other year? So that will not be compatible. And therefore, the Supreme Court in that, first it was Bombay High Court and later on it was challenged in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court upheld the Bombay High Court judgment in that Manjula Shah's case, that yes, the clubbing also has to be, the indexation also has to be begin from the year in which the previous owner has acquired the property. So that is how, students, the amount would be calculated, and this is what would be what your long-term capital gain or loss, LTCG or L, as the case may be. And as I'm repeating to all of you, students, this above principle, the above principle shall apply for category 1, category 2 and category 3. which I have just now have given you in your notes. Like for example, there is a amalgamation only we have discussed just now. So I am the shareholder of the amalgamating company. I am exchanging my shares to receive the shares of the amalgamated company. So in that particular case, also the same thing will apply now. What is that same thing? That is to say, whatever is the shares value which I have received, whatever is the value of the shares which I have received, primarily, that would be my full value of consideration. What would be the cost now? So when I'm selling that amalgamated company shares, when I'm selling the shares of the amalgamated company, so whatever is the selling price which I have received, that will become my full value of consideration. What about the cost of the shares of the amalgamated company? The cost of the shares of the amalgamated company will be the cost of the shares of the amalgamating company. The cost of the previous asset. Okay, now whether the clubbing, whether you will club the period of holding of the shares that you have held in the amalgamating company with the shares that you are now holding of the amalgamated company, and the answer is yes. And based on that, you will decide whether the capital asset under consideration, which is the shares of the amalgamated company, the capital asset under consideration, which is the shares of the amalgamated company, whether this can be considered to be a long-term capital asset or not. So you'll do the clubbing and then decide its nature. And then the indexation also, as I told you, the indexation also would be from the year in which you have acquired the shares of the amalgamating company. You have acquired the shares of the amalgamating company. The same principle, students, will apply on even the category 3 also. The category 3 conversion of the debentures into a shares, or the conversion of a preference shares into the equity shares. So the same particular thing, you will do the clubbing of the period of holding, and then thereafter you will decide whether it's a long term or short term. Just be careful, students, it is now shares that you have transferred. And we have seen for the shares which has been transferred, either it is a listed shares, listed anywhere, doesn't matter. Recognize, unrecognized, for shares we will not see where it is listed. For shares I'm talking about it, whether it is in the listed or listed in the recognized stock exchange or unrecognized stock exchange, doesn't matter. Period of holding would be 12 months. But if it is an unlisted shares, if it is what an unlisted shares, then the period of holding will then be reduced, will then be considered for 24 months. Then it will be considered as 24 months, students. And that exactly how it has to be considered. Fine, students. So I hope that you have to be very careful on these small, small things which are being there for category 1, 2 and 3. It will all be the same. Okay, I haven't seen any sort of a great practical question in your intermediate, but still they are asking here and there, maybe in the form of an MCQ, these concepts of indexations and all of this category 1, category 2 and category 3. Okay, so just be very clear about what I have told you. And let's see the category 4 now, students. Here, category 4. The category 4, which is about the reverse mortgage. So I'm just writing, you can also take a note of this one. Category 4 is your this, miscellaneous. Now, what is this concept of a reverse mortgage, students? 4716. Now, first of all, the reverse mortgage, as the name suggests, what happens herein? This is actually the one of the very beautiful scheme. The concept of a reverse mortgage, it is actually one of the very good scheme which is there for any person who is there in his old age and he has only one house property with himself, but at the same time he does not have any savings. He does not have any savings for himself. And on that note, students, because he doesn't have any saving for himself, he is finding it difficult for his survival. And there is also no other support. In such case, what this person can do, this concept of reverse mortgage, students, has been introduced. So what he will do is that home that he has got, he will do a mortgage of his home. Okay, and by virtue of this, the bank will give him the loan. But that loan will be given to him in the form of a pension. Students, that loan would be given to him in the form of a pension. And without taking him out from the home, so he is retaining his home, he is being allowed to stay in his home, and monthly he has been given the pension. And monthly, students, he has been given what? The pension. So that pension that he is receiving regularly out of that loan, which has been pensionized, so on a monthly basis the pensions are being disbursed to this particular person. So this arrangement, students, somebody may think of over critically that this person, the old man, has transferred his asset to the bank. So if any confusion exists that this old man has transferred his asset to the bank, that confusion should be taken out. They have clearly said that we don't want to make this taxable in the hands of the old man, and therefore very categorically, students, very categorically, they are saying in 47 that this will not be considered as a taxable transfer. So the act of giving my home as the mortgage property to the bank, while allowing myself to retain the possession, this very act will not be considered as a taxable transfer. Is what they are trying to talk about it. So it implies that in my hands, no capital gains will arise when I am giving my home as a mortgage to the bank. See here, what they have written: any transfer of a capital asset in a transaction of reverse mortgage under a scheme made and notified by the CG. Now, as I told you, now they are just giving the meaning the way I have told you. Just we'll read it quickly. The reverse mortgage scheme is for the benefit of the senior citizen who owns a residential house property. In order to supplement their existing income, they can mortgage their house property with a scheduled bank or the housing finance company in return for a lump sum or for a regular monthly quarterly income. The senior citizen can continue to live, this is very important, they can continue to live in the house and receive regular income without the botheration of having to pay back the loan. What will happen tomorrow? Everyone has to die. So if the senior citizen die, then what they will do? The property was already under the mortgage, so the bank will take the asset in their possession, but they will give the chance to the legal heirs. About clearing the debt and taking back the property. But where the legal heirs don't come forward to clear the debt, then the bank will auction it and will take that particular money from this particular asset. Now here, if you see in this context, the loan will be given up to, say, 60% of the value. This is just an example they are giving. Also, the bank or the housing finance company would undertake a revaluation of the property every 5 years. That is fine. You don't have to do all that thing. This is not something that you have to do. All the life insurance and all these things has got no relevance. Okay. Now, at the same time, the pension amount, pension received from the bank regularly, a question may arise that, okay, fine, that mortgage which I have done, the senior citizen who has done the mortgage, that is not considered as a taxable transfer, so therefore no capital gains. But a doubt may arise that regular payment that is being received by me, can that be considered to be a taxable transfer? To that, the answer is again no. Why is it so? Sorry. Can that be taxable in my hands under the head, say, IFOS? Can that be taxable in my hands? That regular pension which I'm receiving on a monthly basis, can that be taxable in my hands under the head IFOS? Again, the answer is no. So again, they are making it very clear that we don't intend to tax this particular person, the senior citizen, neither under the head capital gains nor under the head IFOS. This they have made it very, very clear, students, and that they have done it through section 1043. So if you see again, exemption of income received in a transaction of reverse mortgage, section 1043 further provides that the amount received by the senior citizen as a loan, either in lump sum or in installment in transaction of reverse mortgage, would be exempt from income tax. So that is also only the tick mark which I have done. You just stick around to focus on this, and that is what you are going to revise. Now if you just quickly go through this illustration, it's an all illustration number 5, friends, all the illustrations which are being there. Babita, I have already have uploaded the MTP solution. I have already have uploaded the MTP solution in my this channel, DSTC. My app, if you go to my app, in the test series segment, you will find the MTP solutions. Students, now let's look upon to this particular part. Illustration number 5. Illustration number 5. In which of the following situation capital gains tax liability does not arise? So for point number 1, Mr. A purchased the gold in 1970 for rupees 25,000. In the previous year 1920, he gifted it to his son at the time of marriage. Fair market value of the gold on the day the gift was made was rupees 1 lakh. As we all know, students, this gift, primarily this gift, will not be considered in this regard. And accordingly, we will say what? That it will not be chargeable to tax. So therefore, obviously 47 will come into play. The provision of section 47 will come into play. Now, if you come to point number 2 here, the house property is purchased by HUF in 1945 for rupees 20,000. It is given to one of the family members in previous year 1920 at the time of partition. Again, 47. So these are the kind of a question, students, that you are going to witness. I'm not, in fact, going on one-on-one, but these are the kind of the question that you're going to witness. Mr. B purchased 50 convertible debentures for rupees 40,000 in 1995, which are converted into 500 shares. So same thing what we have discussed, okay? DSB, please ask these queries towards the end now. We'll just focus right on 47. Now, illustration number 6 in this context. Mr. Abhishek, a senior citizen, mortgaged his residential house with a bank under the notified reverse mortgage scheme. He was getting loan from bank in monthly installment. Mr. Abhishek did not repay the loan on maturity and hence gave the possession of the house to the bank to discharge his loan. How will the treatment of the long-term capital gains will be there in the case of reverse mortgage? In all the case, just whatever you have discussed, that the reverse mortgage that has been given, whereby the SSC although has mortgaged the property but is allowed the possession of the property, will that not be considered as a taxable transfer? That will not be considered as a taxable transfer. That is point number 1. Point number 2, students, so far as the exemption, point number 2 is that all the regular income that he is receiving on, say, monthly basis or a quarterly basis, whatever it be, that income also will qualify for exemption under section 1043. So therefore, students, it's the same thing that we have read it, and that is precisely what it would be. Illustration 7, students, you will deal with it at your end. In this context, please go through it, the true and false. Definitions, are you supposed to do it? Forget it. The definition, students, do a cross mark on the definition part. So that is all about section 47 in this regard, which is one of the important area of your question, students. Just be very, very careful about the same. Now, herein, coming to our next particular angle of our discussion, the exemption series, which has been there. The exemption series, which has been there. But before doing the exemption series, herein, students, I would like to quickly run through something on the miscellaneous part, which is there, slump sale. What is slump sale, by the way? Quickly, I'll first do the miscellaneous part, and in the miscellaneous part, students, also do section 50C. Also write section 50C in the miscellaneous part. So miscellaneous part will have this slump sale, advance money forfeited, computation of the depreciable asset, and finally section 50C. So students, first slump sale, quickly. What do you mean by slump sale? Say fast. What is a slump sale? Any idea? Have you all done this slump sale? Quickly let me know. On that basis, I'm going to set you up. I think you should have done it. This is a very popular section in IPCC. Say, students, quickly. Pavan Kumar. Sale of a division. So at least bit of it, you are aware of it. What exactly happens in the slum sale? So students, here in the case of the slum sale, I'll let you know here in transfer of one or more units. Yes. See, it is known as when you are transferring your unit, like I just now told you about demerger. Yes, Pawan. I have just now told you about demerger. So there is a demerger which takes place. What happens? One of the unit is being transferred to a company. One of the unit is transferred to a company. Tharun. Yes, in this case, what happens in this regard? Just pay attention now, students. Here also, one of my unit is what has been transferred. The business division itself is transferred. So here the capital asset happens to be a business division itself. Students, here the capital asset happens to be a business division itself. And that I have transferred to the other person. That I have transferred to the other person without assigning. Without assigning what? The individual values to the assets and the liabilities. So without me assigning any values to the individual assets and the liabilities, if I have transferred that particular asset, if I have transferred that particular asset without assigning any value. Now I can just tell you in this regard, students, like Vijay Mallya. Vijay Mallya has to run away from the country. So in that case, when he, whatever is the asset, what he will say to the buyer, what he would have said to the buyer, like, look, this is the key. Tell me one price of this, my business. Give me one price to my business, that's it. We'll not negotiate about what are the assets in that, what are these things. Tell me one price and this is the key. So that kind of a sale, without assigning the values to any of my individual assets and the liabilities, if you are doing a lump sum consideration you are taking of your business unit or the division that you have transferred, that sort of a transfer is known as a slump sale. So first of all, students, you should always have the ability to identify in the examination that whether the question is that of a slump sale or the question is that of a demerger. So what is that you are going to look into it in the question? The question, you will see that the entire division has been sold, and also the entire division has been sold without assigning the values to the individual assets and the liabilities of that particular division. If this is the nature of the sale, then this is a slump sale. Now, obviously, students, here not a single asset has been transferred. So just imagine and think logically, we cannot have a cost of acquisition of the business, because the business I have built it upon over a period of time. The business I have built it upon over a period of time. So there cannot be a cost of the acquisition. So therefore, unlike in the normal computation that we do, where we have got a cost of acquisition of the asset, here we cannot have a cost of acquisition of the asset, because we have not acquired the business, we have built upon the business over a period of time. And hence, there is a specific computation to be made under section 50B. And what 50B computation says? It says that the capital asset here, the capital asset here in this case is the business division. The capital asset in this case is about the business undertaking. That is your capital asset. The capital asset is your business undertaking, isn't it? Now, whether it is long-term or short-term, the long-term or short-term, it will be considered to be long-term capital asset if the period of holding it for more than 36 months. If this business is for more than 3 years old, then in that case, it is a long-term capital asset. Okay. Or if it is for less than or up to 36 months, then it is a short-term capital asset. Now, having said that, you will do the computation of the capital gains. So when you do the computation, students, over here of the capital gains, in this case, Now 50B is a specific computation, and the full value of consideration, the amount received, the full value of computation is the amount received less what the expense on transfer. If there is any expense on transfer, then that will be reduced, that shall be reduced, which will give you finally the net sale consideration. Net sale consideration, and from this net sale consideration you will reduce only the cost of acquisition. You will say, sir, even if herein even if the capital asset is a long-term capital asset, even if the capital asset is a long-term capital asset, you will say no indexation. No indexation, students, will be allowed in this regard. So forget about any indexation in this context. So even if the capital asset is a long-term capital asset, there will not be any indexation. So what is the cost of acquisition? As I told you, there is as such no acquisition. There is as such no acquisition. So the cost of acquisition in this case is the net worth. The cost of acquisition in this case is the net worth. And how do you calculate the net worth? Net worth would be the income tax value of the asset. The income tax value of the asset, whatever it be, minus the outside liability. Minus the outside liability. That is what you will reduce. And this is what will you will get the net worth. And accordingly, you will get this one. Short-term capital gain or loss, or long-term capital gains or loss. This is how you do the computation of the slump sale. Did you all got this one? Do you all got this one, students? If you are through with this, then quickly we'll do one question, because slump sale, students, is always an important question for your intermediate. For your intermediate, students, slump sale is always an important question. Okay, so let's do it. If you are through with this, tell me quickly, and then we'll go to the question. Fine. Can you tell me the page number? Students, quickly, those who are done with this, they will tell me the page number if possible. Of the practical question. No, there is no such thing. So directly take the question here, students, page 4.418. 4.418. Yes, students. So let's come to this. Mr. A is a proprietor of Akash Enterprises having two units. A transferred on 1st of April 2019 his unit 1 by way of slump sale. When the question itself will give you a slump sale, so it's slump sale. Otherwise, one way of saying is that for a lump sum consideration of 25 lakhs. Another way of putting the question is for a lump sum consideration of 25 lakhs. That is also one of the way they can put up the question. So Mr. A is a proprietor of Akash Enterprise having two units. He transferred on 1st April 2019 his unit 1 by way of slump sale for a total consideration of rupees 25 lakhs. Unit 1 was started in the year 2005-2006. The expenses incurred for this transfer were rupees 28,000. So the expenses incurred for this transfer were how much? Rupees 28,000. So that is in your expenses on transfer. His balance sheet as on 31st of March 2019 is as follows. So obviously we can see for easily that it is a long-term capital asset, because the period of holding of this business, the period of holding for this business is for more than 36 months. So it is a long-term, isn't it? Now, they have given you students the balance sheet as on 31st March 2019. Building is of 12 lakhs. There are two units, and unit one is what has been transferred in the slump sale manner. So building, machinery, debtors and the other assets. And if you see the outside liability, we have got trade creditors, and for the unit one it is 25%, and the bank loan for unit one it is 70%. So as I told you, when you talk about net worth, you will have to take into account only that of that division. Net worth of what? Net worth of that division that has been sold. So the liability that they are talking about it, we will take only that much portion of the liability that belongs to the division one, unit one, and that is what will be reduced from the income tax value of the asset of which division? Again, the division one. Income tax value of the asset of which division? That is division number one. Let's have a look, students, over here quickly. So if you see over here, the building is 12 lakhs, machinery is 3 lakhs, debtors is 1 lakh, other assets is 1,50,000. Other information, revaluation reserve is created by revising upward the value of building. So students, value of building of unit 1. So how much it is there? 3 lakhs. Now under the income tax law, students, we don't get the revaluation benefit. There is no revaluation that we can do it under the income tax law, isn't it? We have seen that the asset in the block, the asset in the block is always at the actual cost. The asset in the block is always at the actual cost is what we have learned. So therefore, the question of this revaluation will not arise, because it is to always, it is to be entered in the block always at the actual cost. So therefore, 3 lakhs would have to be reduced. So if you go here very carefully, revaluation reserve is created by revising upward the value of the building of unit 1. So that I'm going to reduce it. Point number 2, no individual value of any asset is considered in the transfer deed. This is the criteria for being considered as a slump sale. Even though this point number 2 would not have been given in the question, the fact that above they have already said it is a slump sale, it is a slump sale. And point number 3, other assets in unit 1, they are talking about this other assets in unit 1 include the patent acquired on 1st of July 2017 for rupees 50,000, on which no depreciation has been charged. Can anyone tell me, students, what I am going to do about this one? The patent part. Can anyone tell me what I am going to do about this patent part? Quickly. What shall I be doing of this patent part? So students, if you have remembered, we have seen that there is a tangible asset and then there is an intangible asset. There is a tangible asset and then there is an intangible asset, and the patent will fall under the category of the intangible asset. If you see in your PGVP notes that we have done, the PGVP notes, students, that we have done, it is an intangible asset, and for intangible asset the rate of depreciation is 25%. The rate of depreciation is 25%. So 25% being the rate of depreciation, it will be reduced on that note accordingly. So we will reduce 25%, students, which is the rate of depreciation. For how many years I am going to reduce it? 1819, 1819, because on 1st of April of 2019 I'm selling it. So 2 years depreciation I'm going to give it, meaning thereby 20%, 25% and 25%. So 25% first, and then on the WDV, the next 25%. On the WDV, the next 25%. That is how you are going to do it. So other assets will get split like 1 lakh and 50,000 will get reduced to the 2 years depreciation, and the net WDV is what will be considered for the purpose of the valuation of the other assets. The net WDV is what will be considered as the valuation of the other assets. Let's have a look, students. So net sale consideration is fine. Let's see the net worth. Building. So this is the income tax value. Income tax value because no revaluation is allowed. Machinery 3 lakhs, that is fine. Debtors, where is the debtors? 1 lakh, that is also fine. Now see the patent part. Now at 50,000, other assets 1 lakh, I told you 1 lakh, and this is 50,000. Then the 2 years depreciation. So first year 25% on this, and then second year 25% on this WDV, which comes to 9375, and WDV is 28125, and therefore your patents is 28125, other assets 1 lakh, 14 lakh, 28,125 is the total income tax value. Income tax value. And from this, the creditors, but only that outside liability which pertains to unit 1. Only that outside liability which pertains to unit 1. That is what has been reduced. And therefore, finally, you'll get the net worth. Finally, students, you are getting the net worth. Did you all got this one? Did you all got this one, students? All of you. So this is one question which I have done with you, and that should be all. Hopefully now. Thereafter, coming back to the other miscellaneous part, which is being there. Advance money forfeited. Students, you may be aware. Let me give you a case study quickly. On the advance money forfeited. You can also take a note of this case study. So how do you go about it, students? So father acquired the land for ₹100. This is on 1st of April 2003. Then advance money forfeited. By father, ₹20. This is 1st of April 2007. Then, father gave the land to son as gift. 1/4/2009. Son has forfeited the advance money of ₹25. Then 1st April 2016. Son has forfeited advance money of ₹20. And finally, 1st July 2019, son transfers the son is transferring the land. for rupees 200. Students, I want you to comment like this. What is the answer for point 1, 2 and 3? I want only the answer for 1, 2 and 3. I want only the answer for 1, 2 and 3 in this regard. All of you. Quickly, 1, 2 and 3, only write like that. 1, this is the treatment, 2, this is the treatment, and 3, this is the treatment. Let me see. I'll give you 2 minutes time. Trinath, other students also will reply quickly. Nishank, DSB. No, give me the answer like 1, 2, and 3 the way Trinad has given. This will be very confusing for me also. Pawan, what about 3? I have first fine, Nishank, 2 and 3. DSB. Fair enough, students. So, Thomas. So I got hold with your proposition now. Let me then come into picture. If you are all done with this, friends, then last 2 minutes now. Not 2 minutes, 1 minute. 30 seconds, in fact, to be very precise. So last 30 seconds, friends, let me see. if you all can get the answer right. Those who want to give the last try. 20 seconds. DSP. And yes, indeed, students, here the answer is no treatment. There won't be any tax treatment. Here, the answer would be reduce from the cost of acquisition. And here everyone has got it right. IFOS would be there. How come you say that this is IFOS? No, Thomas. One is no treatment. I'll explain. How come you say that there is no IFOS over here? So you say that there is no IFOS students over here because what? Because in this particular case, students, be careful. Any advance money forfeited on or after 1st April 2014, that will be charged under the head IFOS. So there is no concept now. If I forfeit the advance money on or after 1st April 2014, then there is no concept of reducing that amount from my cost of acquisition. There is no such concept now. Earlier there was this concept, but now this concept no longer exists. So what will be reduced, students? Now you'll say, sir, then why you have not reduced this? I'm coming to this. The advance money forfeited by the SSC only shall be reduced. What would be reduced? The advance money forfeited only by the SSC. Only by the SSC shall be reduced. Only by the SSC shall be reduced. This is the law. So students, in this case, the SSC is the son, not the father. Father is no longer the SSC. So when you calculate now the capital gains finally will be calculated like this. Full value of consideration, 200. Less from that ICOA. And when you calculate the ICOA, you will have the cost of the previous owner, which is 100. 100 is the cost of the previous owner minus the advance money forfeited into CII of year 1920, into CII of year 1920 divided by CII of year 2003-2004. So that is what will be reduced, and finally the amount, long-term capital gain or loss. Again, I'm repeating, students, this 100 is what? Cost to the previous owner, and this 25 is the advance money forfeited by the SSC. The advance money forfeited by the SSC. So that is what will be considered for the purpose of reduction. The net cost will then be applied for the indexation benefit. The net cost will then be applied for the indexation benefit, and the period of holding, students. Index cost of acquisition. Why index cost of acquisition you are giving? Why index cost of acquisition you are giving? The index cost of acquisition is given because period of holding that I'm going to consider would be from 1st April 2003 to what? To 1st July 2013. 1st April 2003 to 1st July 2019. 1st July 2019. Students, ensure to deal with this one. All of you are through with this. So therefore it is a long-term capital asset. You'll write like, therefore it is a long-term capital asset. And because it is a long-term capital asset, we will give the indexation benefit. Did you all got this one, students? If you are all through, then we go to the next particular concept in the miscellaneous area. All of you are through with this one? Fine. The next concept, students, is that of the depreciable asset. The next concept is there is the computation of the capital gains in respect of the depreciable asset. Is the concept, that indexation benefit I have given. That's the reason why we are starting with the indexation from 3-4. We are starting from the indexation from 3-4, applying the principle of the Supreme Court in Manjula Shah's case. Now, the depreciable asset, students, here, there is one special point when you calculate the capital gains in respect of the depreciable asset. What is its special point? What is the special point when you calculate the capital gains in respect of the depreciable asset? What is the special point? Can anyone tell me what is the special point in calculating the capital gains for the depreciable asset? Quickly. What is the special point in calculating the capital gains in respect of the depreciable asset? Say fast. There is one special point, students. Pavan has said the answer. Students, whatever be the net result of the computation, the gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset, gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset will be available only if the asset, students, the gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset shall be available only if the asset has been transferred. The gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset, the gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset will always be considered as a short-term capital gain or loss. That is what Section 50 does. So one of the key feature of the computation of the depreciable asset is that whatever is the gain or loss that will arise, whatever is the gain or loss that will arise on the transfer of the depreciable asset, that gain or loss will always be considered as a short-term capital gain or loss. Always. That is what the Section 50 is all about, friends. That is what the Section 50 is all about. Did you all got this one? So just one point which I thought to make it very clear in your mind about the nature and the scope of Section 50 is concerned. This is what this particular point that you should always keep in mind. Okay. So again, I'm repeating, students, gain or loss on the transfer of the depreciable asset will always be considered as a short-term capital gain or loss. For one more point, which before I go to this real issue, which they have targeted in the examination, one more point. Students, under what circumstances the capital gains will arise? Under what circumstances the capital gains will arise on the transfer of a depreciable asset? So what is that circumstances when the capital gains will arise on the transfer of the depreciable asset? For that, students, you need to travel back to our concept of the block of asset. You need to travel back to our concept of the block of asset. What is that concept of the block of asset which I have taught you, students? If you can recall. The concept of the block of asset which I have taught to all of you was this, that when the SSC receives the money, when the SSC receives that money, and if the money value of that asset which he has transferred is higher as compared to the money value of the asset that he has received is higher as compared to the opening WDV and the additions made during the year, then that particular gain will be considered for the purpose of short-term capital gains, because your entire cost has been absorbed by the selling price of the asset that you have transferred from the block. So your entire cost has been absorbed, and therefore this will result into, now you will not get any cap, now you will not get any depreciation, but now it will result into a short-term capital gains. That is point number one. Point number two, students, would be when you have sold the entire asset from the block. When you have sold the entire asset from the block, then in that case also, your calculation for capital gains has to be made because the block has ceased to exist. The calculation of the capital gains has to be made because the block has ceased to exist, and that capital gains that will be calculated will be deemed to be a short-term capital gain or loss. That capital gains which is calculated will be deemed to be a short-term capital gain or loss. This is what is the competition so far as Section 50 is concerned. So that is the two cases. Again, be very clear, students. These are the two cases where the capital gains will emerge in respect of the depreciable asset in that block. Case number one, when that one asset which has been sold, its selling price is much higher as compared to the opening WDV and the actual cost in respect of the new addition. Therefore, the entire cost is fully absorbed in that one transfer of that particular asset, on which the selling price is very high as compared to the opening WDV and the actual cost. That will result into a short-term capital gains. That will result into short-term capital gains. This is point number one. And point number two, which I have told you, was about that. The second point, which I have told you, was about what? Was about the fact that the asset which has been transferred, the asset which I have transferred, that asset in this regard, the entire asset from the block has been transferred in a way that the block has ceased to exist. Therefore, the question of claiming the depreciation now will not arise, and hence now we have to calculate whatever is the capital gains or loss when the block has ceased to exist, and that capital gain or loss will then be considered to be a short-term capital gain or loss. That capital gain or loss will be considered to be a short-term capital gain or loss. This is what is a two ways in which you will get the capital gains. Always remember this point, students. Now, that question which I wanted to answer, students, ICAI has asked in intermediate level this question, a brilliant question, students. Now, they have asked, which is generally for CA final student. But two times I have seen for IPCC. That is based on that Bombay High Court decision in Ace Builders Private Limited. Please try to understand the kind of a question which has been targeted. Now you have got that short-term capital gains. Okay. Now you want to claim, like for example, the land has been transferred, or the building, the company has transferred its building, the factory building. Okay, that factory building has been transferred, and therefore it has resulted into short-term capital gains in one of the two situations which I have just spoken to all of you. So it has resulted into short-term capital gains. Now, whether for that company for whom that asset is a depreciable asset and the block has resulted into a short-term capital gains, can the company can claim a 54EC exemption? Can the company can claim a 54EC exemption against that short-term capital gains if it has made the investment, if it has made the investment of the net sale consideration in the notified bonds required under 54EC as per the conditions therein? Will it be eligible for 54EC exemption? Quickly, students. DSB, and the answer is yes. Students, the answer is yes in this case. Why the answer is yes? please come to this one. Have you all done this one? By the way, I just wanted to know this part. Have you all done this one or not? You'll say, sir, but we have not done exemption in the class as yet. In the class, we have not, right now, we have not done it. Any case, the next class, I'm going to come on the exemption only. But have you done this concept earlier? This part concept? Because this was asked in the intermediate examination 2 times. Students, if you see over here, 54 EC. In this context, I think this is your chart number. So tomorrow we will run through this entire chart. Chart number 21. If you see very carefully, 54 EC exemption is available to any person. Yes. Nature of the capital asset, long term. What is required is the nature of capital asset and not the nature of the capital gains. Capital gains may be a short term capital gains, but what is required is the, what is required, friends, repeat, what is required is that asset should be a long term capital asset. So please pay attention, students, and please focus on this point. The last point, which I'm explaining to all of you, that a depreciable asset in the block, repeat with me, the depreciable asset in the block, if held for more than 24 months in respect of building, I'm talking about it, because building is an immovable property, the real estate, and for the real estate, the long term would be when it is held for more than 24 months, isn't it? So the depreciable asset being a building, if held for more than 24 months, will be considered as a long-term capital asset. But the gain arising on its transfer will be deemed to be a short-term capital gains as per section 50. Okay, so the gain is deemed to be a short-term capital gains, but the asset continues to remain as the long-term capital asset. The gain is considered as a short-term capital gains, but the asset continues to remain as a long-term capital asset. And therefore, if you see, again coming back on this part, students, if you see very carefully, the nature of capital asset, this is the long-term, and that is the criteria that is required, and not the nature of gain. So is that depreciable asset? Was it a long-term capital asset? And the answer is yes. So therefore, now, even though the gain is a short-term capital gains, but if the consideration on its transfer is invested where? In the notified asset, and the other conditions are also satisfied, then the exemption under section 54 EC will be available. Exemption under section 54 EC will be available. Keep this point in mind, students, because this is the only point which is very, very critical so far as this particular the depreciable asset computation is concerned. Okay, so therefore you are requested to be very careful on this part. And the last one, students, which is there, which is section 50C, I'll do it tomorrow now. 50C, students, that is what we are going to start tomorrow first, and then we will do the what is the next one that we are going to do? We are going to do the next one is your 54 series exemptions. So this exemption chart should be there handy with all of you. Because this is what we are going to touch upon in the tomorrow's class along with the practical problems. So tomorrow target is to complete the exemptions anyhow. Okay, so that is where we are going to touch upon, and the last lecture we are going to do the tax rates. So this thing is completed. Also, students, Sunday lecture which I am going to take, I'll finish the tax rate, that is first part, and second is also IFOs we are going to finish on Sunday, so that the next week then we do are the, you can then tell me which is the priority areas of the topic that you want me to do. I'll do it in that particular order. Now you can ask me the query, students. DSB, first class of basic, you gave example of PGP 1.75 crores and short term capital gain is 1.5 crores. That first class, which is tax rate. Okay. You told the surcharge on 1.75 crores at 25%. Okay. And no, if I have told it, no, in that very case, I, no, if I have told it, just check it, then it has to be redone. I would have thought at that time it is some 2.75 in my mind. for this one. But yes, see, the concept, I'll tell you DSB. First of all, the concept of the higher surcharge is the other income, other than this two incomes, long-term capital gains of 112A and the short-term capital gains of 111A. Other than this two incomes, which is there, you have to see whether the normal income, does it exceed the threshold of 2 crores or 5 crores as the case may be. If it exceeds the threshold of 2, if it exceeds the threshold of 2 crores or 5 crores, only then the higher rate of surcharge of 25% or 37% as the case may be would be applied. This is the concept. Okay. So if the calculation on the maybe we would be gone very far. That time you should have told me at that stage itself. Anyway, so I stand corrected if this is the example which I have given it to all of you guys. So maybe instead of 1.75 crores, please take it as 2.25 crores. If in the my first lecture I have taken as 1.75 crores for PGBP and 1.5 crores for short-term capital gains, and we have still applied the higher surcharge of 25%, so please make this as 1.75 as 2.25. That PGBP of 1.75 as 2.25. Again, I'm repeating the concept. What is the concept? Other than this two incomes, 111A and 112A, other than this two incomes, if your other, the normal income, if it exceeds the threshold of 2 crores and 5 crores, then the tax on that normal income, on that tax, higher rate of surcharge will be applied of 25% or 37% respectively. And the tax on this 111A or 112A, on that the normal surcharge would be applicable. The normal surcharge would be applicable of 15%. I hope that now I stand it clear. Nishank, 2.5 crores. I don't know now. But whatever it be, I just stand corrected. If 1.75, just whatever it be. So you take the PGBP as more than 2 crores. It has to be more than 2 crores because that's a provision. Okay. I don't know now whatever is the figures which I have taken the number in my first class. But I have told you the concept now, students. So just see that figures and accordingly make that particular calculation. So students, tomorrow all set. First is 50C. Tomorrow lecture is very important lecture because 50C is also equally important. And then this 54 series exemption is equally important. And why I am very much interested to go to IFOS, because of the gift tax. Why I am interested to go to IFOS very soon? Because of the gift tax. Because here the seller sells and there is 50C. Then there is a buyer also, for him there is a gift tax in respect of the immovable property. Okay, so that is the reason why tomorrow agenda is set till exemption. Day after tomorrow, which is on Sunday, we will be doing the two things. One is the tax rate and second is what? Second is the IFOS. Okay, so that will be completed. And then Monday onwards, I will then see, frankly speaking, I'll tell you one more thing. House property, if you want me to do, whether you want me to do house property, I can do it, but it is simple topic. If you want me to do house property, I'll do house property on Monday, or else you decide. See, just see your priority, which you want to accelerate, because your priority is important. Yes, tomorrow possible at 8:30, possible from my end, not an issue. 8:30, 8:45, we can start tomorrow. In your group, in the WhatsApp group, students, you are all there, isn't it? So I think in the WhatsApp group, you are all there. So you would be, I'll be shooting that link to all of you. Let's see, DSB, I will do the price. That's the reason why I want to do away with this simple topic a bit later. I will then take a call, maybe. We can do, I think after this too, let's do house property then on Monday. Okay, key areas of house property. I think the rest of the topics only require key areas because they are small topics, and on the key areas, the big areas are PGBP and CG, and rest of them are only the key areas that you should revise it. Like for house property, the GAV calculation, and second is the interest on that loan borrowed. These are the two areas of the house property, GAV calculation and and the interest part. That is all of it, isn't it? So these are the two areas only that you have to be very careful about it. Apart from that, see, salary and chapter 6 students, your involvement is more important, because about the number crunching exercise, I have told you earlier also this particular part. And finally, set off topic and this one, the set off topic which has been there, better we'll try to do it in the total income question. We'll try to do it in the total income question. And I will try to invest some time in doing you with for you advanced tax, some TDS and interest question, so that that is a practical question. You will get it in the MCQ also, and also in the MCQ you will get it, these questions, and also as a standalone practical question. Yes, yes, you in the group itself you can freeze this topic and then we can do it in that particular way. Okay, so anyway, see you then students tomorrow then. Let's meet up tomorrow. Thank you. Good night to all of you.